Hi, boys and girls. Today, our read aloud is called Three Young Pilgrims. I really like this book, and there are a couple of reasons that I really enjoy it. The first reason is that when you open the book up, you'll see this map. And this map shows the United States, and here's Canada, and England. So here's the ocean, and here's the Mayflower. The Mayflower crossed the Atlantic Ocean. And there are just little bits of information that show where things happened. One of the things shows that Oceanus Hopkins was born at sea. Remember the story that we read talked about the little girl that was born and they named her after the ocean. It also has a compass rose. Remember that shows us the directions of north, south, east, and west. We've got lots of different information. And then at the back, it shows about the Native Americans. And the page before that talks about the strangers. The pilgrims were not the only people on the Mayflower. The people who came on the Mayflower for their religious freedom were called the saints. Those were the pilgrims. And this has a picture of all of them and tells a little bit about them. And then the next page are the strangers, and they came for opportunity, not because of religious freedom. They came to get their own land. So there are lots of different bits of information that are in this. We also have a map of Plymouth. Remember, Plymouth is where the pilgrims built their homes. So this is talking about the Plymouth colony, and it tells you what you'll find and where. Down on the bottom, we have a timeline. It shows the time period for when different boats came to the New World, where we live, America. It shows that in 1002, Leif Erikson sails to the New World. So he would have been one of the first ones that we know about. That was before Columbus. In 1492, Columbus found Hispaniola and Cuba. And then we have different voyages and explorations that came to the New World. Here are some things that happened in the world about the time of the pilgrims. So there's a lot of history in this book. And it's based on true people who were aboard the Mayflower. Now, I can't say that this is all fact and real, because we only know little bits of information. When you're telling about something from history, you have to either have read it in a letter someone from that time wrote, or in a book about that time that was written. We only can kind of piece together those little puzzle pieces and try to figure out what happened back then. So this story is talking about a family. Some of it is probably true. Some of it is probably made up. We're just going to read and find out what we can from the story of three young pilgrims. It's about kids. Mary, remember, and Bartholomew stood on the deck of a little boat in the very middle of dark blue ocean all around. They watched for mermaids and whales, pirates, and most of all, land. Isn't that a neat name? Remember? Mary, remember, and Bartholomew are sisters and a brother. Down below their feet were the dark, bad-smelling rooms for the people and their bundles. Below them was the hold full of cargo and barrels of food and water. Below all this was dark, cold seawater, where Mama said fish swam through the bones of poor drowned sailors. Now, this is kind of a cool picture because it has labels. It tells us that up here, You have the main topsail. Here you have the mizzen, the main course, the crow's nest. The crow's nest is where they stood to watch for land. The foresail, the forecourse, the spirit sail, the main mast, the beak, the rudder, the keel, the anchor lines, and then you've got all the different parts under the decks. The cargo is down here. And remember that the cargo is stuff that's being carried to the New World. So like boxes and barrels of things. Things that are being taken somewhere are called cargo. And the Mayflower was a cargo ship, not a passenger ship. It had been 60 days since the ship sailed from England. Finally, one cold November morning, there was a shouting. Land! Land ho! 'Tis America! The pilgrims strained to see a pale ribbon of land. Every morning, the thin line on the horizon was thicker. Mary wondered if bears were watching from behind the tiny trees. Captain Jones told the sailors to drop the Mayflower's iron anchor into the sea. Papa said, "Tomorrow we will row ashore to see if all is safe. We'll find the best place for our colony, and our new baby will be born in the New World." Mama blushed happily. To make sure everyone would stick together once they reached shore, the pilgrims wrote an agreement. They were there to build a colony for the glory of God and in honor of our king and country. Together, they would be a civil body politic, making and obeying laws for the common good. So everybody that was on the Mayflower signed an agreement saying, hey, when we get to that place, we'll stay together, we'll make laws, we'll become our own society, and we'll work together so that we can be successful. It was scary getting into the little boat. Everyone's legs were wobbly after so many weeks at sea. But then, how wonderful to run on the solid land. Mama and the other women washed their family's clothes in the water and spread them out to dry on the rocks and bushes. The children went exploring. "Don't go off too far," the mothers called. Mary thought she saw a face peeking from behind a rock, but when she looked, there was no one there. That afternoon, the pilgrims returned to the Mayflower. It would be their shelter until the place to settle was found. It was an important decision. Finally, just before Christmas, Papa said to Mama, "We found a fine place to build. We will call it Plymouth Colony." Mama smiled. "I'm glad, Isaac." The children saw that her face was thin and pale. They felt worried. Everyone was hungry and tired of living crowded together on the damp, smelly ship. On the land and on the gray rolling sea, the days and nights were growing cold and bitter. Now here is the land and the ocean, and you can see where the boat traveled looking for the best place to build their colony. They didn't just stop at the first place. Mary watched snowflakes melt into the salty sea. She could hear the ringing of axes and pounding of hammers. The sounds carried clearly across the water from the land where Papa and the others were building shelter as fast as they could. Some of the grown-ups were beginning to be sick. Mistress Mullins had died of the sickness. Mr. Bradford's sad, silent wife had fallen into the sea and drowned. Mary shivered and wished that the new baby would come, that spring would come, and that they could all be warm and safe together in their own house with supper in the kettle. So while they're building the houses on the land, they all have to stay inside the boat, right? In the next weeks, those who were strong enough moved their belongings from the ship to the common house and to their own half-built houses. One dark winter evening, Papa built a smoky fire in their own hearth. That night, Bartholomew, Remember, and Mary warmed their fingers with their whispered prayers and bundled up with him and Mama. The family listened long to the sound of the woods before falling asleep, and the wind blew cold off the sea. On the 16th day of March, Mary found tiny spring flowers in a clump of melting snow. Remember said, "It must be spring." Mama said, "Winter is most dark and cold just before spring." In the darkest winter, half of the pilgrims had died of the great sickness. Mama and the new baby died too. A tear slipped down Bartholomew's nose. Then he saw the Indian. So a big sickness had taken so many during the winter, and their mother had passed away and the new baby. And then they saw the Indian, the Native American. He stood quietly at the edge of the woods and looked at them with keen, dark eyes. His skin was the color of copper. The children turned and ran to find Papa. They found him trying to break up the rocky soil of their garden. "Papa, come with us." "Not now," he began in a weary voice. They pulled on his hands. "There's an Indian." They saw the tall man walk up to Mr. Hopkins and Mr. Bradford. "Welcome, Englishman," he said in a loud, deep voice. "My name is Samoset." The thin, sad pilgrims came out of their fields and doorways to see the Indian. After spending the night with the Hopkins family, Samoset went back to his home in the forest. When he came back, he brought his friend Squanto with him. They brought food and later showed the settlers how to plant corn a new way. In each hill of corn, they buried small fish. Remember planted the herbs and flowers Mama had brought. When no one was looking, Mary planted a fish too. On a pearly April morning, Captain Jones sailed away on the Mayflower back to the old world. Many of the pilgrims wiped away homesick tears. When the ship was a glint on the horizon, now the horizon is this line where you see the sky and the land or ocean meet, that is called the horizon line. So when the ship was a glint, a tiny little thing on the horizon, they walked back to their work. This was home now. All down the warm green summer days, everyone tended their gardens and crops in the fields. The corn stood taller than Mary could reach. When Priscilla Mullins and John Alden were married, Remember brought primroses from Mama's garden. That fish must have helped, Mary smiled to herself. There was going to be a rich harvest. Well into the cool blue evenings, the pilgrims worked gathering in the squash, peas, beans, barley, and corn. Herbs for medicine and seasonings were tied into sweet-smelling bunches. After the Sabbath prayers and hymn singing, Governor Bradford stood before the congregation. His collar was very white beneath his sunburned face. "We will invite our Indian brothers to feast with us and offer prayers of thanksgiving to the Maker for a bountiful harvest." It would be a fine thing to do. Nobody had forgotten how it felt to be cold and hungry. For days, Plymouth was filled with the good smells of cooking. A company of men had been sent to the Indian village with the invitation to the feast. Massasoit, the great leader, Samoset, Squanto, and nearly 90 other men emerged from the shadowy woods wearing feathers in their black hair. The feasting went on for 3 days. As the deer brought by the Indians roasted and food was set out on long tables, the men challenged each other to see who was strongest and whose feet ran fastest. Late at night, Papa and his children sat at the edge of the circle of firelight. There was singing, and far off they could see the harvest moon rising out of the ocean. The moon path of light might have led all the way back to the old homes in Holland and England. Mary sat in Papa's lap, munching a bit of berry tart. Bartholomew asked, "Papa, are you happy we came to America?" Remember frowned at her brother. She didn't want Papa to be sad. Mary looked up into Papa's dark eyes. After a time, he said, "Your mother and I wanted to bring up our children where no king could tell us how to live and pray." He sighed. "We didn't know it would be so hard. But yes, I am happy." "And what of you children? We've had a devilish hard time, and we've had to be brave, but are you happy?" Papa's voice was very soft. Bartholomew watched the fire and the men who had begun to dance and said, "I think I will be, Papa." Remember squeezed Papa's rough fingers and smiled up at him. Mary wished that Mama were there. Papa's arms tightened around her. Feeling warm and safe, she whispered, "I wasn't happy." Papa's soft whiskers brushed her cheek. The four of them listened to the singing and the sea. Way past bedtime, away from the fire, the moon lighted the paths leading home. Now we have the pictures that are at the back, and that's the end of the story. Could you imagine how hard that must have been? To have left everything and everyone you know, and to go out and have to work so hard, and then to go through such tough times and losing your mom, it would be really tough, wouldn't it? So they've really had to be a very brave family. I always like this book because it has the names of those who were on the Mayflower. And one of the names that was on here is Billington. My mom, when she was not married yet, was named Bullington. That's her last name. And we've done a lot of family history. We haven't been able to figure out exactly, but they've been in America for many hundreds of years. So we kind of think they might have been related to the Billingtons that were on the Mayflower, and that the name got changed. But the funny thing is, my family was not so good. They were not, I'm trying to find them. I think they were not pilgrims. They weren't the saints. They were the strangers. Yes. And it says John Billington. So if I'm related, this is them. They were the strangers. They were not there for religious. 10 years later, he would be hanged for murder. And then his son, in the New World, he got lost in the woods and was found living with the Nossets, which are the Native Americans. So that's kind of crazy. If that's my family, we were not such good people. But I have other stories in my family that prove that some of us were not. Anyway, it's kind of fun to look at the names that are shown. Some of your last names may show up in here. I don't know. When I was looking at the Indians, there are all these pictures of different things that are native to the New World. So things that they could find here: tobacco, leek, squash, gourds, crookneck squash, acorn squash, Kushaw squash, pumpkins, beans, corn, oysters, blue mussels, scallops, a quahog, I'm not sure if I say that right, clams, cod, bluefish, eel, herring, alewife, rabbit, bear, deer, beaver, bird's eggs, raccoons, maple syrup, lamb's quarters, watercress, goose, duck, turkey, crab apples, walnuts, groundnuts, strawberries and gooseberries, wild currants, blackberries, chestnuts, acorns, Jerusalem artichokes, and onions. All of these foods are native or from here, and some of them they may have never had before. So I just think it's a very cool book. Hope you have a great day. Talk to you soon. Bye.